Royal babies are just massive, massive assets.
This latest addition to the royal family will be a California girl.
I love the idea of doing selfies by Buckingham Palace, going to Sandringham.
But every royal baby is a celebration for the nation.
The royal family is this country's family.
All Windsor births are a moment in history, from palaces to private hospitals.
She did go in for the hypnobirthing method.
Royal babies always deliver drama.
Poor Zara had given birth on the bathroom floor.
Steeped in tradition, protocol, and destined for duty.
They're put to work the minute they're born.
Prince, princess, and baby prince emerge to the cheers of the crowd.
The country loves...
Singing, well done, Charlie, let's have another one.
..a royal baby.
Bloody hell, give us a chance.
But as the House of Windsor gets its biggest shake-up for a century...
If one of those godparents is Oprah, they may want to keep that to themselves.
What will the future hold for the next royal generation?
I think we can either go forward into a new age or we can go backwards.
Another great-grandchild.
The last four generations of the Windsor dynasty have welcomed 30 new babies into the world. They may have won the hearts and minds of the British public, but Harry and Meghan's latest pregnancy created a royal first.
Hi.
Hello.
Thanks for
when
joining us.
Sensationally revealed in the Oprah Winfrey interview the sex of their baby in waiting.
First of all, let's say, congratulations.
Thank you.
Meghan said she wanted to wait until you were here to tell us, is it a boy or is it a girl?
You can tell her.
No, give her.
No.
It's a girl.
This little girl will be quite different. She will have dual nationality and she will still be in line to the throne.
I think 100% the Americans are going to feel this is our royal baby.
The Sussex baby is very unique. It's the only one that we know of that will ever have the chance, slim as it might be, to be both monarch and president.
For the last 100 years, Windsor babies have celebrated the past and heralded the future.
If you look at the few things that unify a country, it's royal weddings and royal births.
We're all sitting there like meerkats. OK, when's the baby coming? When's the baby coming?
Can you imagine knowing, whilst you're walking down the aisle of St. Paul's Cathedral, my next duty is to provide a baby? That was her role.
Within 3 months of marrying Prince Charles, Diana was pregnant.
I remember going to photograph her at the Guildhall or somewhere like that in London, and she wore this big coat.
The princess was, for once, rather coy with the photographers.
It has provided a memory that glows by this morning's announcement that your royal highnesses are to be blessed with a child.
And it was wonderful because she was this young, beautiful young woman. It was the completion of the fairy tale.
But not all Windsor pregnancies have such happy beginnings. In 2012, Kate was less than 12 weeks pregnant when the press got scent of dramas unfolding behind palace doors.
The Duchess is suffering from acute morning sickness.
Catherine Middleton was very sick, and it was like a puke chart was created in the papers for her.
She was so ill that she had to be on a drip. And obviously the world had to know because, you know, William had to make a dash to the hospital and there was no way that she was going to keep her pregnancy secret.
Family rallied to support the Duchess.
Can you guys please? How's Kate doing? Is she doing well?
I think many people were very concerned, not least because she was carrying the future monarch, but also because she was under so much scrutiny and how awful to be in that situation, feeling so ill.
Intense press attention also fell upon Harry and Meghan when their first pregnancy was announced at the start of their 2018 Australasian tour.
Their tour began with news that they were expecting a baby. And tonight, as they leave New Zealand, they will surely look back on a trip that went beyond expectations.
This is unusual because Royal Baby announcement is always going to generate a lot of press coverage. So that was almost two competing stories, but it seems that the couple didn't think they could hide it any longer.
But second time around, they were able to take a more controlled approach, releasing an intimately composed image taken by friend and professional photographer, Missen Harriman.
We saw them lying on the grass with a tree overhead, barefoot, and Meghan holding her bump. And that's much more laid-back Californian lifestyle compared to the formal announcement coming out from Buckingham Palace.
She doesn't like the clandestine way the palace operate. So she thought, well, I want to share this with the world. And so she did. She's under no restrictions anymore.
I think the press gets a little bit discombobulated when a royal baby comes along because the media isn't nice.
Well, in the 80s, the press were much more intrusive. It was really, really unpleasant stuff. Princess Diana was on holiday with Prince Charles in the island of Eleuthera, a private island, and she was sunbathing in a bikini and in the bushes.
I've got these great pictures of Diana in a bikini.
You know, it was the long lenses, almost trying to conduct an external scan of the fetus. Signs of a bump, signs of a bump.
We sent them to London, then we were ordered to come back straight away. I arrived back in London and there was uproar. There was a massive row going on about it.
And the Queen was furious. And she called a meeting of the Fleet Street editors and said, you've got to leave this girl alone. You're endangering her unborn child's life.
Today, no one would publish the pictures. It's just a completely different era now.
During the post-war period, pregnancy fashion reflected attitudes of confinement and covering up, and the Queen's clothes mirrored this approach.
Well, most royal ladies would not be seen when they were pregnant. There is a couple of pictures of the Queen, but there are very, very few.
But fast forward 60 years, and the Windsors were out and pregnancy proud.
I don't know what it was about 80s fashion. Everyone looked like tense.
Both Fergie and Diana wore these voluminous maternity smocks, which at the time were fashionable.
I think in some ways that was a sort of liberation because pregnant women were allowed to let it all hang out, but also you were expected to cover the bump.
It was all the puffy sleeves, the polka dot. There was Fergie in her sailor's costume.
She was a fashion football that we kicked around, that poor woman, to our shame.
In the 21st century, royal mums-to-be combined style with practical sophistication.
Catherine, of course, looked so elegant and had some beautiful sort of coat dresses made. Being so tall, she just looked wonderful. Meghan went for the more trendy look of showing the bump and wearing tight clothes. She would always have her hand resting on her bump. Poor girl, she was criticised for that, which is quite unfair because where else is your hand going to go?
Baby shower thing is an American idea, like trick-or-treating.
Baby showers are as far from British tradition as you can get.
I was told having a baby shower is bad luck, whereas in America, nothing's really bad luck. We want to celebrate everything.
Meghan's baby shower was held in New York's exclusive Mark Hotel. She and her girlfriends had the run of the penthouse suite. It was reported at the time that she was lent private jets and the hotel bill for over £200,000 was picked up by her pals.
We had never seen someone throw this very lavish affair to celebrate the sort of impending arrival of a baby.
Well, this is what happens when your grandson marries out.
Meghan flew to New York mid-term. Wouldn't you think that would be dangerous?
It was just so trashy looking because they walked in through the front entrance carrying these enormous bags from the most expensive baby shops in New York. Crowds gathered because they were all celebrities. There was Gail King from CBS, there was Serena Williams, and then, of course, there was Amal Clooney.
And I remember speaking with the Palisade at the time, who rolled their eyes. They were horrified that something so common was happening within the House of Windsor.
But baby showers were just a sign of times to come. A century of royal baby protocols was about to be ripped up.
Meghan herself said to friends that she felt under pressure to serve Archie on a silver platter.
The due date of Harry and Meghan's baby girl is a closely guarded secret. But there's one thing we do know for sure. She will be born in California.
Meghan will probably be in this beautiful white room with fresh orchids and maybe whale music, perhaps a cool sea breeze being wafted in magically by Oprah Winfrey herself. Yeah.
There's a lot of speculation about where Harry and Meghan's daughter might be born. Cedar Sinai in Los Angeles has seen some of the finest maternity suites in the country.
Kardashians, Beckhams and Madonna have all given birth at Cedar Sinai, where deluxe maternity suites reportedly cost up to £2,800 a night. Wherever the Sussexes choose to have number two, it will be a very private affair. But this has rarely been the case for royalty through the centuries. The Queen was born in the family home, Bruton Street, Mayfair, just before the general strike of 1926.
The Home Secretary had to attend the birth because in those days, Home Secretaries had to validate that it was indeed a royal child.
This was absolutely necessary because the Queen Mother's body was owned by the state and the child was also owned by the state.
The Queen Mother banished her unwanted guest to adjoining room. And 22 years later, her daughter scrapped this ancient tradition when she gave birth to Prince Charles at Buckingham Palace. By all accounts, it was a long and difficult labour.
Prince Philip went down to the squash courts in Buckingham Palace and had a very vigorous game of squash. And then footmen ran down there and said, "Oh, Your Royal Highness, you know, your wife has given birth." So he dashed upstairs with a towel round his neck and he presented the Queen with a bunch of white flowers.
The Queen gave birth to all her children at home. But the next generation of Windsors would move from palaces to private hospitals.
The Queen would have preferred the Princess to have her baby here at the palace, but in the event, it's assumed the Princess bowed to medical opinion.
Princess Anne was the first of the Queen's children to use St Mary's Hospital Paddington, but it was Princess Diana who made it truly famous.
The Princess is in the private Lindo wing. Not all rooms look over the front, so she may not be able to see the crowd.
The royal doctor practised from St Mary's Hospital, and that's why they all went there.
Besides the impeccable bedside manners, private hospitals had other important perks fit for royalty.
You get the very best service.
And you can order pretty much whatever you want, very much like a room service menu in a hotel.
But such luxury was a veneer to the stark reality of giving birth at the Lindo in the 1980s.
When I had my daughter in the Lindo wing, it was very old-fashioned. It was really quite shabby. And the bathroom was across the way from the bedroom. I was in the same room where Diana gave birth, and it just looked out on a brick wall, really.
Unlike his father, Prince Charles was present at the birth of his son and heir.
The crowds began to gather just after 8 this morning, and they've stayed here all day in alternate sunshine and showers.
I think Diana had a long labour, and she was under a lot of pressure, and she was tearful. She had little tricks, like she would suck ice cubes, she'd have, you know, a sort of flannel on her forehead. It was like all sort of old-fashioned.
Well, I'm hoping she won't keep us here all night.
Would you like to see a baby boy or a baby girl?
I would like her to have a boy, and I should think if she's having all this trouble, it's a boy.
When Prince Charles emerged at 11, they roared their congratulations.
Prince Charles is extremely emotional, and he was so excited. He wanted to share it with the world, and he was almost mobbed. Somebody kissed him on the cheek, and they were shouting questions at him.
How do you feel? I'm obviously relieved and delighted. It's marvellous. It's rather a grown-up thing, I find.
You could see he was bursting with pride.
They have been singing Well Done, Charlie, Let's Have Another One.
Really?
On the programme of events.
Bloody hell, give us a chance.
31 years later, Kate followed in her late mother-in-law's footsteps.
She revealed that she did go in for the hypnobirthing method and that it was very much a mind-over-body experience, trying to control the pain and get on with having a baby, essentially.
Kate's calm deliveries were in sharp contrast to the dramatic arrival of Zara and Mike Tyndall's baby Lucas.
Mike Tyndall got on his rugby mate's blog and described how poor Zara had given birth on the bathroom floor.
It was run into the gym, get a mat, get into the bathroom, get the mat on the floor, towels down, brace, brace, brace.
Oh, my God.
Mike's hijack of the Good, the Bad and the Rugby podcast became perhaps unwittingly the most graphic account of a royal baby birth in Windsor history.
The midwife who was going to meet us at the hospital, it wasn't that far away, so she drove up and got there just as we'd assumed the position. And then the second midwife arrived just after the head had arrived. Wow. So, yeah, it was a bit garnish, but...
Holy Moses.
I think as far as royal births and royal baby announcements goes, this is sort of as far from conventional as you can get. But actually, it summed up life in lockdown and real family life for so many.
Through Marble Arch came the Royal Horse Artillery. What a lovely fuss can be created by the arrival of a small human being weighing 7 pounds, 1.5 ounces.
The firm's obsession with succession runs deep. Royal babies are still announced with 41 gun salutes. A notice on the gates of Buckingham Palace.
Major Marsham of the Queen's household hung up the framed proclamation of the birth. It read, Her Royal Highness, the Princess of Wales, was safely delivered of a son at 4:20 p.m. today.
It seems like such an archaic thing to do. But actually, it's such a funny period, that time, when the baby's been born, but there's nothing to show for it.
So we're from ATM. Can you tell us how the princess is?
She's very well, thank you.
And your son?
He's in excellent form too, thank goodness.
With the birth of William, Charles and Diana created a new Windsor rite of passage, the private hospital steps photo opportunity.
Less than 2 days after arriving here, Prince, Princess and Baby Prince emerged to the cheers of the crowd.
Not just a story for Britain, it becomes a world story. And, of course, they know that.
It's lovely, I'm all excited. And somebody else's champagne on me and help me along.
They're great days, they're happy days, they're joyous days.
All the best, Diana!
But at the time, little thought was given to the pressures faced by a 20-year-old Diana.
More crowds, more congratulations, and a homecoming party tonight.
I think Diana was very, very stressed. Apparently, she said that as soon as she got round the corner, she just burst into tears. They got back to Kensington Palace and Prince Charles went off to play polo.
Less than an hour later, Prince Charles left, something most new fathers would hardly dare to suggest.
I don't think that would happen now. I think people would be horrified.
3 decades later, Kate chose to run the same gauntlet.
In the street outside the hospital, it seems the whole world is watching and waiting.
We want Kate! We want Kate!
As Prince Charles visited Yorkshire, there were already gifts for his new grandchild.
Thank you very much.
It hasn't quite appeared yet.
Six is going to appear in 6 hours' time.
Six, I believe, we might do that.
Congratulations, Kate Wilde!
But unlike Diana, this royal mum knew what was coming and went on the offensive.
I remember being so surprised for the arrival of Prince George to see hair and makeup arrive through the side entrance of St Mary's Hospital.
Welcome! Humble duty! And future king!
Catherine rather charmingly had the polka-dotted blue dress, and it was similar to a dress that Diana had worn. So it was a tribute to her late mother-in-law.
Very emotional. Yeah, it's very emotional, and it's such a special time. I think any parent, I think, probably sort of know what this feeling feels like.
So. Very special. On the other side of the camera, people don't realise that there's 60, 70 photographers. There are 20 news cameras, not just from the UK, but from the US, the Commonwealth. It's a very unnatural production.
Catherine did come into criticism because she looked so immaculate. Her hair was beautifully blow-dried and she looked amazing. And other mums thought, this is setting a standard too high.
She has to be nice at all times and dignified. What does that mean? That means we pounded her, and she didn't crack in public.
All three of the Cambridge children were paraded to the world's press on the steps of the Lindow Wing. But when it came to the Sussexes' firstborn, it would be a very different story.
Meghan herself said to Friends that she felt under pressure to serve Archie on a silver platter.
So they did their bit, but it wasn't quite enough for us.
Archie was born at the Portland Hospital, but the press were bewildered when the Sussexes made a secret dash back to Windsor.
Prince Harry does it his way, I mean, or Meghan does it her way, through us all.
Instead, Harry went to the Mews at Windsor and gave a little interview.
I haven't been at many births. this is definitely my first birth. But it was amazing, absolutely incredible.
You could see he was so overjoyed that it was really lovely.
This little thing is absolutely to die for, so I'm just over the moon.
It was great that he came out. And then later on, they went to Windsor Castle.
It was a private moment in St George's Hall, just them and a couple of photographers, three sanctioned questions for them to sort of share their happiness with the world.
The Duke and Duchess were asked if they show a little more of Archie's face to the cameras, and Harry willingly, if gingerly, did so.
Wow.
He's already got a little bit of facial hair as well. Wonderful.
Thank you, everybody, for all the well wishes and the kindness. Mm. It just means so much.
You know, she hadn't lost, her baby weight like Catherine did, and he went... But Meghan was still looking very, very mumsy, but it was charming, really charming.
That was widely interpreted as a message to new mums. This is natural and normal. Don't feel you have to bounce back into your pre-pregnancy weight in days or weeks.
Whether or not Meghan was making a statement about how young mums could or should present themselves, when it came to Archie's christening, she and Harry would once again take controversy to a whole new level.
There were some people who were clearly a bit miffed.
It was never actually revealed who were the godparents, so we just did a guessing game.
The arrival of a royal baby is a time of great national celebration. But usually, the child has barely been born before everyone is a flutter over its name.
Are you still thinking about names?
Still thinking about names, Alan.
Well, I'm hoping for George, and if I was a betting man, I believe it is a reasonable bet.
What I do find extraordinary is over here there's, you know, bookies making guesses on what the next royal baby is going to be named, and people actually betting on this.
This time, we know only that the couple have a short list of first names so far, and that the baby's family name is Mountbatten Windsor.
I knew it would be a George, of course. And a Louis, of course. And a Charlotte to match the George. William was so predictable. I didn't get Archie Harrison.
Have you thought of a name yet, sir? Have you thought of a name yet, sir? Have you thought of a name yet?
There
It's not a 102. It's a bit of an argument about it.
Choosing a name is the first great challenge for any royal parent.
We're actually presented with this very small pool of royal names that already have history within the family. It's hard to be original. It's hard to give the name to the child that perhaps you secretly want.
William will be king, and we will have Queen Kate. So their children, they're presented in a very traditional way. They're still dressed in a very traditional way. They have Charlotte, George, and Louis, which are very much royal names.
The closer you are to the throne, the more traditional a royal baby name kind of needs to be. But as you step away from different generations and different cousins, for example, you can be a bit more left of field.
I think Princess Anne was the one that sort of slightly started to do things differently when she called her daughter Zara, which means bright as the dawn.
The princess, joking with the nurses, said, "She's quiet, isn't she?"
And then, of course, in turn, Zara has called her children less traditional names.
I think Mia and Lucas are Zara Phillips' children's names. They're, you know, my children's schools are full of Mia and Lucas's.
Harry and Meghan's baby, of course, was Archie, which completely took the public by surprise.
So it shows you that they weren't going to go with tradition, that they were going to go with a much more relaxed name, but also going with the name, I assume, that equally both of them just really liked. It's just Archie. They really liked the name.
Meghan and Harry marked themselves out as forward-thinking royal parents in their choice of name. Yet in Meghan's shocking revelations to Oprah Winfrey on American TV, the traditions of royalty seem more important to the couple than the public had previously been led to believe.
What was happening behind closed doors was, you know, we knew I was pregnant. We now know it's Archie, and it was a boy. We didn't know any of that at the time. We can just talk about it as Archie now. And that was when they were saying they didn't want him to be a prince or a princess, not knowing what the gender would be, which would be different from protocol.
The couples claim that their children, contrary to long-standing tradition, would not get titles, became one of the interview's biggest controversies.
We thought, we understood, that one thing they didn't want was for their children to be encumbered with royal titles, but obviously they did.
But just what are the rules about giving titles to royal babies? In 1917, George V declared that all grandchildren of the monarch would be a prince or a princess.
This means that as soon as Prince Charles becomes king, all of his grandchildren are entitled to the HRH status, as well as that title of prince or princess.
But Meghan claimed that this rule would be changed in Archie's case, meaning he would not receive a title.
The couple wanted a title for Archie, not just because of the legacy that title would carry, but also because of the benefits that come with it, the royal security.
In the Oprah interview, Meghan implied that the denial of Archie's title came in tandem with the shocking new revelation.
So we have in tandem the conversation of he won't be given security, he's not going to be given a title. And also concerns and conversations about how dark his skin might be when he's born.
What? About how dark your baby is going to be?
Potentially, and what that would mean or look like.
Ooh.
I think that the link was an emotional link that was made between that terrible question and the line of succession.
And you can then understand why Harry might take that quite personally. How warm a welcome is that to the royal family's first mixed-raced senior family member?
As he arrived for his christening, it was apparent that there is now another royal the cameras will love.
Royal christenings are very important, like royal births.
The monarch is the head of the Church of England, and those within the succession may well become head of the church. So therefore, the christening is about anointing the person who will be head of the church.
Consequently, Windsor christenings have become steeped in tradition. Up until 2004, all royal babies had to wear a robe that dates back from the 19th century.
It was Queen Victoria that commissioned the beautiful, beautiful christening robe which is made of Honiton lace. It's 170 years old, that room.
Between 1841 and 2004, 62 royal children were christened in Queen Victoria's robe.
Granny was christened in this.
Great-granny. And then it was deemed that this robe was going to fall apart if any more royal children squeezed into it. So a replica was made.
The Queen's dressmaker stained it to make it as close a replica as possible, and she used Yorkshire tea to do the job. It's been worn by Prince George, Princess Charlotte, Prince Louis, and most recently their cousin Archie.
Royal children are baptised in another of Queen Victoria's heirlooms, the silver gilt lily font. And the water used comes all the way from the River Jordan.
I imagine at Buckingham Palace they have a vault where they've got their Jordan water supply. And just like in the Queen Vic on EastEnders, they'd go, we're running low on Jordan, you need to change the barrel. And they'll send an equerry or someone off to the River Jordan and get his bucket and come back with more.
Yet none of these royal rituals and traditions are seen by the public.
Those intimate moments inside the chapel have always been off limits to the public.
But there is an agreement that afterwards there will be a photograph, and also there'll be a lineup of the godparents, which will be released to the press.
Harry and Meghan, however, took the privacy of a royal christening to another level.
Behind the tall walls of Windsor Castle is where fewer than 25 guests were invited to witness the newest royal baptism. Those invited taken discreetly to the tiny private chapel.
It was so sad because Archie got christened in the private chapel at Windsor and there was absolutely no pictures released and it was never actually revealed who were the godparents. So we just did a guessing game.
There were some people who were clearly a bit miffed.
We do pay for the royal family, including Meghan and Harry, and I think that they could have given us a little, you know, a little something.
Other people were saying, well, good for them, you know, doing whatever they can to protect the privacy of their family.
If one of those godparents is Oprah, and I'm not saying that she is, then you can understand why perhaps they may want to keep that to themselves, because even Oprah sitting down to interview them was controversial enough in itself.
Once a royal baby has been adopted into the Church of England, it's not long before duty calls.
Prince George has done the seemingly impossible, stolen the limelight from the Duchess of Cambridge, despite her best efforts.
The world loves royal babies. They're put to work the minute they're born.
The moment you're out of the womb, they should pop a crown on your little head, avoiding the soft spot.
A baby passed from father to mother with an affectionate pat on the head.
And I think we saw that most with George. After his arrival, very quickly, he was rolled out in front of the public at Taronga Zoo in Australia.
But newborns hadn't always been so centrally involved in royal duties.
100,000 gather to see Princess Elizabeth, whose popularity increases daily.
In the Queen's era, it was taboo to take royal babies on tour.
I mean, it was very, very difficult being a royal mother with the Queen. She had to leave her children behind. And Nanny would ring up, you know, on a very crackly telephone line and say, well, you know, they've just got a new tooth come through, or little vignettes, but they were still without their children.
When the royal couple returned from their 1951 tour of Canada, Prince Charles hadn't seen his mother for over a month.
The thing that strikes me about the images of Charles waiting to see his mum is how sad that she didn't sort of scoop him up into her arms. Diana changed all that when she was invited to bring Prince William to Australia with her and Charles. I mean, when they actually got there, she didn't see that much of him because he was whisked off with his nanny. But she said very sweetly, at least we're under the same sky.
The 1983 tour coincided with a national debate about whether Australians wanted to keep the Queen as head of state.
First fly on it already.
Of course, at a time when the country was questioning the role of the monarchy for Australia, well, what better prop can you use than a baby to warm the hearts of a nation?
Prince William himself demonstrated that he's serious, self-confident, almost nonchalant. But like any other six-month-old, he'd not yet understood the phrase, being on your best behaviour.
While a royal baby can often appear angelic to the adoring public, for the parents, it can often be a different story.
Anyone who's had a toddler will know that their ability to embarrass you in sensitive situations is just without parallel.
By now, a tearful Prince Harry had had enough. Prince William, on the other hand, still had a fair amount of energy left.
They're masters at that craft. And of course, royal kids are going to be exactly the same.
There was a picture of Charlotte having a meltdown with Catherine and William.
George was in the helicopter simulator. She wanted to get into it as well, and she was talking to Mum, and she threw herself on the floor. I remember it.
It must be so hard because you know people are looking at you. You know that the paper's going to write, oh, naughty meltdown. The kid's not being naughty. The kid's frustrated and behaving exactly as a frustrated three-year-old should do, which is howl.
Yet a royal toddler's most embarrassing moments often occur when they have an opportunity to play to the public gallery.
Princess Charlotte, of course, famously caught sticking her tongue out at some of the photographers. May have been more of a reflection of how she knew her parents felt about the photographers that tailed them along.
She's so adorable, and of course they make great pictures.
We saw Prince Harry doing exactly the same when he was 4 or 5. He was quite famous for sticking his tongue out at the photographers.
Harry, I think from an early age, felt he was in a theatre. And it was all amusing that people were staring at him. So, of course, he played up. And he acted his role.
All Windsor children face the challenges of a life spent in the public eye. But the home front can be just as difficult, particularly when it comes to controversy in the royal nursery.
One of the papers reported that they'd been through 3 nannies and that they must be terrible people to work for, but very few people know the real story behind it.
When a royal baby is born, the eyes of the world focus on the skills of the new parents. But behind closed doors, someone else is just as important in the child's upbringing.
Well, royal nannies are the backbone of everything. They are so important.
Oh, my God, you have to keep so many secrets. Fancy not being able to gossip about your employer. I used to be a nanny. I used to gossip so much about the mums I worked for. You don't believe what she did. Can you believe she did that with her baby? With her own baby. That's what I was like when I was a nanny, the whole time.
Certainly in Victorian times or even in the Queen's own time, there would have been multiple nannies, probably even a nanny per prince or princess. That's not the case anymore. We know that Kate and William have one nanny, so of course, often, Kate and William will have to roll their sleeves up and get stuck in themselves.
You only need to look at the Tyndalls. Zara and Mike don't have any nannies in their life. Ultimately, in their home, it's just them.
As with so many things, when it comes to nannies, Harry and Meghan have decided to do it differently.
I remember speaking with a source close to Harry at the time, who said that when they welcomed Archie to the world, they did not want a sort of Mary Poppins type character around their child as he or she grew up. And I would take that as perhaps a slight dig at the Norland nanny style.
Established in 1892, Norland nannies have been the royals' go-to childcare for generations. While Harry and Meghan may have decided this elite service was not for them, they didn't find it easy to settle on an alternative.
One of the papers reported that they'd been through 3 nannies, that it was all a big mystery and that they must be terrible people to work for. Very few people know the real story behind it. So after Archie's arrival, Harry and Meghan wanted some help to establish a sleep pattern. They hired a night nanny. Whilst I can't go into someone else's employment details for legal reasons, it was an incident on one of the very first nights that put the couple off from having a night nurse.
Then a second nanny was brought in to replace her, but by that time, apparently, Harry and Meghan had decided that the whole night nanny thing wasn't really for them, so she didn't last long either.
So they moved on to number three, which was a woman that worked for them for quite some time, actually, until they moved to California. She helped them out on a very much a 9-to-5 basis. It was a great working relationship, actually, despite reports.
I would personally cut them slack for having three nannies. You're not going to get the perfect person. It takes time to figure out what's best for your family.
Whatever battles may be going on behind closed doors, royal parents will also struggle to keep their child out of the public eye.
I think every royal parent is very keen to try to give their children as normal an upbringing and normal childhood as possible. Of course, it would be ridiculous to say that those upbringings are normal. They're not.
It was the first public appearance of the Cambridges as a family of four. William and Kate, George walking, holding his father's hand, and today's centre of attention, Princess Charlotte, not yet 3 months old.
There is a conflict between wanting to be normal and wanting to maintain one's royal position. By saying that you are royal, you are saying that you are different. Who wants to be normal anyway? Normal people don't want to be normal.
It may be some time before Charlotte is seen in public again. Her privacy, like Prince George's, will be fiercely guarded.
The public gaze and the need for security make it hard for royal children to have everyday lives. But since becoming a mother, Kate has brought a new perspective to royal parenting.
It's not surprising in some ways because she's the first royal mum who had anything like a normal upbringing herself.
A keen amateur photographer, Kate releases photos of private moments through social media, giving the public a more intimate insight into family life than they've had previously with other royals.
Catherine does a brilliant job. See, when you're the mother, you see the children at their best, playing with each other or falling around where they're in happy mood.
One image in particular has proven Kate's talent for capturing the family at their most open.
Everybody's looking at her. Everybody's smiling and so happy. Now, I challenge any photographer to get that picture.
I do remember the first day the boys went to school in their uniforms, and always the princess accompanied them.
We got used to seeing them going off to their London prep schools, going off before that to their nursery school, being taken by Diana, and that became very much part of royal life in London.
Unlike any other child in the country, a royal child's first day at school is witnessed by the press.
None of their school life was private. Every time they started at the nursery school, we were there. When it was their school play, we were there. I mean, William told his policeman one day, you know, I hate photographers. He said, I hate photographers. William, of course, was very shy, and he hated it, and, you know, being on parade like that. That's why William today won't let his children go through that. I mean, when they start school, one photographer does it. And it's all agreed beforehand.
Kate and William have managed to limit the paparazzi access to their children's school life. But in LA, will Harry and Meghan's kids enjoy the quiet life their parents left Britain for?
I think the big difference is with Archie and the new baby being schooled in America, those children probably won't know that he's the great-grandson of the Queen. Whereas if he were schooled over here, every parent, probably every child, would absolutely know that they were and they are the great-grandchildren of the Queen.
So just what will the future hold for Meghan and Harry's children and the family they left behind in the UK?
We may have Archie and his sister deciding to perhaps take on careers in Hollywood. You know, I think there's so much talk about whether Archie or his sister might become president one day or take on a life in American politics.
I feel sorry in a way for the Sussex children, that they won't witness that rich tapestry, that history of being a royal child.
I wonder if Archie and his little sister will have different accents over the years, whether Archie has already got an American accent. He may well do.
I love the idea of Harry and Meghan's Californian daughter being a real tourist, sort of coming along, doing selfies by Buckingham Palace, going to Sandringham and, oh my God, we're going hunting. Oh, well, I'm a vegan.
Harry and Meghan's baby will be shouted about to all over the world. So I think all eyes will be on California and on this new royal baby arriving on the other side of the pond.